Welcome to part three of our series entitled Prophecy, Peace, and Power. This will be the final installment for this series. If you were not able to join us for parts one and two, let me just very briefly go through where we have been. In part one, we begin by pointing out that at the end of time, it is not merely the magnitude of the disaster that matters. It is instead the magnitude of the response to that disaster that ultimately matters the most. In other words, an end time event doesn't necessarily have to be an end time level event in and of itself. It's the response to it. How does the world respond when this particular event takes place? That is the scenario that ultimately helps to usher in the final events of Earth's history. In part one, we also looked at major developments of the end times, particularly about the economic demotion of the United States. If the United States is to fulfill the role in prophecy that God speaks about in His Word, then it needs to be taken down a notch, but not too far. It can't be destroyed, no. Instead, it seems to needs to be made in such a position that it is open to doing the bidding of someone else. And that would obviously require a change. We talked about how it might be that COVID-19 could be at least an example of how that particular demotion could take place. And I just want to remind you, there has been some good news this last week regarding COVID-19, and that has been wonderful. It's been nice to hear about some peaks as far as mortality rates and maximum use of resources, etc. There are some places in the world that are reaching that point, and they hope coming down the other side. Alas, Virginia is not yet one of those. Our peak is still off in the future, a week or two. But there is some good news. But that all said, in spite of the glimpses of good news, even previously reluctant news outlets are now turning their attention to what may become the bigger problem, and that is indeed the growing economic impact from COVID-19. Now, I'm not going to repeat all that I said in part one. I would simply point out this. The economy tends to be a lagging indicator. You say, what does that mean? Well, that means that even though, for instance, COVID-19 can make an instant impact on somebody who contracts it, their physical health is immediately impacted, the financial fallout can wait quite a while, particularly when we're talking about for the globe. The next 6 to 12 months on this planet, economically speaking, are very uncertain. International Monetary Fund recently said that roughly about 25% of its member nations are asking for major, substantial financial assistance. Usually there's only a handful. Now there's 50 of them, 50 countries that are saying we need help and we need it now. Unemployment rates are skyrocketing. We live in very interesting times. Again, I do not know if this is indeed how this piece of the puzzle, this economic piece of the puzzle, prophetically speaking, falls into place. I am saying we need to keep our eyes wide open and pay attention because we live in interesting times. In part two, we looked at this particular question. Will the COVID-19 crisis lead to the very end of time? And if so, how soon will that come? And we said if we're going to answer that question, whether it's about COVID-19 or anything else, we need to use our prophecy toolkit. And this toolkit has at least five tools in it. We looked at having the importance of, number one, the Holy Spirit leading us. Number two, Bible study, the real thing. We can't just take Bible prophecy and spend our post and break looking at it and hope to come up with tangible, excellent results. No, it's going to take some time. Number three, we need to use Bible study aids. The Spirit of Prophecy, the Seventh-day Adventist Bible study commentary on Daniel and Revelation. These are excellent resources that can help to guide us and understand what the Bible is speaking about prophetically. Number four, we need a balanced view of time. We're not to live on time excitement. We're not to set dates, certainly, but we do keep watch so that we can know when the end is near. And number five, we said we need a humble appreciation of the counsel of others. When we learn something from Bible prophecy, we need to bring it to our Sabbath school class, we need to share it with other people. Iron sharpens iron, and we learn from others so that we don't go off the deep end, or perhaps on the other side, that we help them to understand we are living close to the second coming of Jesus Christ. All of these things, we said, were there to help us develop maturity. And oh, is it needed when you're talking about Bible prophecy. Jesus is coming again, but we cannot afford to be people who live on time excitement, or on the other hand, fall away when things don't happen as quickly as we wish they did. God is looking for mature followers. Those are the ones that he can entrust with top-level end-time assignments. Which brings us to part three. In part three, I want us to take one final brief journey in that list of end-time appointments, end-time developments. You'll recall that we went through a list of things. I pointed out that it's not necessarily, these are not things just 1, 2, 3, 4 chronologically in order. This is exactly how they will happen one after the other. But nonetheless, these are the broad categories. Repetition is the mother of learning, and so I want us to look at these things here. Let me quickly go through them on your screen. Major developments of the end times. Nature begins to unravel. That continues until the second coming. Wars, famines, pestilence, that all increases. Religious liberty begins its unstoppable decline. It starts out with this being restricted in some ways. Ultimately, religious liberty goes away completely. The sealing of God's people, the settling into the truth as it is found in Jesus Christ. The latter rain of the Holy Spirit. The shaking of God's people, this is where those that are in the church, if they are not firmly attached to Jesus Christ, there will be circumstances that will shake them out. The gospel goes into all the world. Matthew 24 talks about this. The loud cry, Revelation 18. Global persecution. World powers unite with the Roman Catholic Church and the Protestant United States at their head. There's the rise of global deception via spiritualism. We've hardly had any time to talk about that one. We'll have to save that for a future time. The threefold union occurs between the Roman Catholic Church, Protestant America, and spiritualism. This is the unholy trinity. There's the early time of trouble. The mark of the beast, global Sunday law comes. The Sunday laws we talked about last time is progressive. It doesn't just throw a switch. There's restrictions that come, first of all, regarding the day, and then ultimately there comes a death decree if one does not worship as a sign of allegiance on Sunday to the beast power. Probation closes. There's the full time of trouble. The last plagues fall, not on the righteous, because probation will have closed by then, but onto the wicked. And finally, God's people are delivered at the second coming of Jesus Christ. And that all said, I'm reminded of a quote. This is from Testimonies, Volume 9, page 11. This is what it says. She says, "We are living in the time of the end. The fast fulfilling signs of the times declare that the coming of Christ is near at hand. The days in which we live are solemn and important. The Spirit of God is gradually but surely being withdrawn from the earth. Plagues and judgments are already falling upon the despisers of the grace of God. The calamities by land and sea, the unsettled state of society, the alarms of war are portentous. They forecast approaching events of the greatest magnitude. The agencies of evil are combining their forces and consolidating. They are strengthening for the last great crisis." And then comes this famous phrase. If you've spent any time around Adventism, you've probably heard this before. "Great changes are soon to take place in our world, and the final movements will be" what kind? They will be rapid ones. The final movements will be rapid ones. Rapid ones indeed. I need to remind us, just in case we've forgotten the obvious, the last month has shown us clearly that life as normal can become life abnormal with mind-bending speed. But today, I want us to pause and kind of pull back from looking at the prophetic event side of things. I want us to kind of go up here to 1,000 feet or so. Let's get a bird's eye view of what it is that we are experiencing right now, a bird's eye view of where we stand, and perhaps more importantly, how we stand. Now, here's what I mean. Let me put something here on the screen for you. Jesus had this to say. When he was speaking about the end of time, he said this. He said, "Because of the increase of wickedness, the love of most will grow cold." Now, to me, what's troubling about that statement is that Jesus does not make a distinction. In other words, he's not saying for people of the world, for pagans, for people that rebel against God, their love will grow cold. No, it's a blanket statement. Because of the increase of wickedness, Jesus said, the love of most. In other words, Christians, non-Christians, people that go to church, people who don't go to church, the love of most, he says, will grow cold. And he even makes this statement, Luke 18, verse 8. But when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth? When the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth? And I must tell you, even to this day when I read that text, it's a little bit ominous because Jesus doesn't answer the question. If you read the text, that's the end of that particular story. It finishes there. Jesus did not intend to provide an answer. He wanted us to provide the answer. When the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth? In other words, I think Jesus is asking this. When he returns the second time, will he find that we have waited for him poorly or that we have waited well? How can we wait well for Jesus? We've talked about all kinds of events, some of which are happening right now. We've talked about events that are to come here. How can we face these stormy events, wait for Jesus, and do it well? Well, let's do a little bit of digging. If you have your Bible, I encourage you to look at Luke chapter 6, please, verse 46. Luke chapter 6, verse 46. Now, if we're going to find out how it is that we can wait well for the return of Jesus Christ, it is tempting that we would only look at Bible prophecy. Well, we're going to look here at a parable that Jesus told. It's usually referred to as the parable of the wise and foolish builders. And I don't know that this is necessarily an apocalyptic passage here. In fact, this is kind of Luke's version instead of the Sermon on the Mount. But I think you'll easily see how it applies to the days that we live in right now, the end of time. This is what Jesus said. Luke 6, beginning with verse 46, he says, "Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not do what I say? I will show you what he is like who comes to me and hears my words and puts them into practice. He is like a man building a house who dug down deep and laid the foundation on rock. When a flood came, the torrent struck that house but could not shake it because it was well built. But the one who hears my words and does not put them into practice is like a man who built a house on the ground without a foundation. The moment the torrent struck that house, it collapsed and its destruction was complete." A number one key, and I am strongly tempted to say the number one key to waiting well for Jesus' second coming, is to be real. To be real. I mean, how else can we say it? Particularly in light of what Jesus just said here about the wise and the foolish rulers here, builders, we need to be real Christians, particularly at the end of time. Not people that are faking it, not people that are hypocritical, not people that have this veneer of Christianity, but people who truly know Jesus, who really follow him, and who really put into practice what he has asked us to do. And now let's be clear, as we've talked many times here, we've seen from the Word of God, we're not saved by our good works. We're not saved by doing these good things. But if we are saved, we will do these things, because now we are no longer living in darkness, we are living in light. We are not living in the way of the flesh or of sinfulness. We're living in the way of Jesus Christ. And so, yes, these good things are going to follow. Ellen White put it this way, Prophets and Kings, page 626. She said, "Christians should be preparing for what is soon to break upon the world as an overwhelming surprise." Pause right there. In other words, the rest of the world, you remember other places in the Bible where Jesus said, at the end of time, there'll be marrying and giving in marriage, and peace and safety will be what people are saying, and then the end will come upon them like a flood. It will be a surprise to those who persistently refuse to hear the counsel of the Word of God, but not for those that study the Word, not for those that know Jesus. "Christians should be preparing," she says, "for what is soon to break upon the world as an overwhelming surprise, and this preparation they should make by diligently studying the Word of God and striving to conform their lives to its precepts." You know, as odd as it may sound, in light of this, the truth is that the global COVID-19 super crisis, though it has brought great pain and suffering, has also provided Christians with a profound opportunity to practice being real in the end of time. In other words, even if this is not the end, we don't know, But it most certainly is a dry run, a practice run for what is most certainly coming. You say, well, how is it a practice run? Well, in the matter of just a few weeks now, millions upon millions of believing Christians have had their rights dramatically reduced, their health profoundly threatened, their governments intrude dramatically into their lives, and the right to public assembly drastically reduced or eliminated. In other words, get this, they have been reduced to being a New Testament Christian church. That's what's happened. They have been reduced to being a New Testament Christian church. You say, what do you mean? Let's think about it. Because of COVID-19, we can only legally meet in small groups, and even then, only for certain functions. Well, that sounds a great deal like the New Testament Christian church to me. You know, for much of Christianity's history in the first 1, 2, and 3 centuries of the AD era, Christianity was outlawed. It was an illegal religion. At least some certain practices of it, key practices, were outlawed, and many times just outlawed outright. And so if you gathered as a Christian, it could cost you your life. Furthermore, today, though not hostile at this point, the government has eliminated our ability to spread the gospel freely, at least in the ways that we are used to. We cannot gather, for instance, in person with non-believers for an evangelistic series. We can't gather in person for cooking schools. If we had journeyed to Bethlehem right now, we couldn't have journeyed to Bethlehem right now because we can't gather with this size of group. Our schools aren't meeting. Even the things, the public community services efforts from our hospitals, those things cannot happen. They can respond to those who are sick, but the whole idea of gathering together in our institutions, no, that's gone, and so much more as well. And of course, the New Testament church was not able to do many of those things either. In fact, the New Testament church often didn't even think in those terms. We didn't own buildings in those days. How could we possibly have had large gatherings in our buildings when we did not even have those? Institutions were well off in the future, and consequently, we are now getting a taste of one of the most intriguing end-time questions that one can ask and answer. Here's the question: can the church survive and even thrive without its institutions, its buildings, and its programs? I say it again. Can the church survive and even thrive without its institutions, its buildings, and its programs? And if we go deeper, it's really asking a little bit more of a disturbing question, isn't it? Questions like this: are we Christians or are we consumers? Are we converted to Christ or to religious programming? Are we converted to Christ or merely to a different way of life than the rest of the world? Are we converted to Christ or to the ability to socialize every 7 days with people who think like we do? Now, to be clear, I like socializing with fellow believers. I like our school system, which is doing quite well considering the circumstances right now. I like our ability to meet together as we wish. I appreciate the blessings that have come from our institutions. So I'm not denying that at all. But we must also be honest. At the very end of time, all or nearly all of the bells and whistles, the institutions, the programming, etc., that we have become attached to will be banned. They will be shut down. Or if any of them do continue, it will be heavily modified and used to serve the needs of church-state politicians, not Christ. So, given all of that, will we survive the transition? I mean no harm when I say it is a sad fact that what too many call church is actually nothing more than a mere collection of buildings that act as a staging grounds for a collection of various felt need programs that serve youth, young adults, the elderly, a variety of community needs, etc. And again, such churches undoubtedly do good things. I'm not denying that at all, but so does the Rotary Club, so does the Lions Club, so does the YMCA and the Red Cross, etc., etc., all of which do genuine good, but none of which are the body of Christ. But the real church, real Christians, the real body of Christ is the union of those who have given all for Jesus. Their heart, their soul, their mind belongs to Christ, and all that they have or do is for His glory. Their warmest thoughts and affections are focused on Him, not on the world, and they are living today with a soul eye towards living with Christ in the kingdom to come. They are strengthened by fellowship with other believers. Hear it well. They are strengthened by fellowship with other believers, but they are not addicted to it. They will do all they can to seek out that fellowship, meeting in the catacombs, as it were. And today we might say that's, you know, reaching out by phone, video conferencing, email, exercising outdoor togethers with appropriate social distancing, etc., etc. But even if their fellowship with other believers is minimal, their fellowship with God remains strong as ever. They are blessed by corporate worship services, but they are equally blessed, and sometimes more so, by their regular private time with the Savior. And notice carefully, if it were to happen, and at the end we are told that it will, that all the blessed trappings of, quote, church are stripped away, the buildings, the services, the programming, the subsidies, the schools, the hospitals, the large fellowship gatherings, if all of these are stripped away, and yes, if the safety of a predictable religious routine is stripped away, real Christians will still be most decidedly, unflinchingly, unwaveringly a faithful member of the body of Christ, His church. In the COVID-19 crisis, we have a dry run. At the very least, this is practice. At the very least. And will we prove to be mere consumers who fade when the programming stops, or will we prove to be the real thing, real Christians through and through? Now, there is good news. And the good news is that there is no secret as to how to be a real Christian. This is not rocket science. This is not complicated, for which I'm very, very glad. And there are three things that I would say, and those of you that have paid attention over the last several years will already know what these three things are. The three things are quite simply prayer, Bible study, and ministry. Prayer, Bible study, and ministry. If you do these three things, great things can come to pass for you, the greatest of which is that you can become a normal Christian. A normal Christian. Because what we do here in the 21st century, in the very end of time, should not be any different from what the first century apostles did when the purity of the gospel was there, you know, this birth of the kingdom of God. This is what they did to be real Christians, and we can do the same. Just very briefly, we've seen these before, but let's briefly unpack prayer. Ellen White has this marvelous phrase. It stuck with me. I hope it sticks with you too. We should speak to Jesus as one speaks to a friend. Speak to Jesus as one speaks to a friend. Jesus is not looking for ways to keep us out of the kingdom. He's looking for ways to bring us in. He's on our side. What better person to talk to share our praises, our thanks, our wants, our desires, our irritations, our disappointments. Lord, why am I still shut up in this house for the umpteenth day, right? He is the one that we need to go to on a daily basis throughout the day. Pray with Him, talk with Him, and listen for His response by His Holy Spirit. Studying the Bible. This is how God speaks to us in very concrete ways. This is the Word of God, it's called. It tells us how we can know the Savior, know His heart, know His will for these days. The Christian who does not study the Bible, who does not have His Word somehow as a regular part of their lives, is not a healthy Christian. They cannot be, because this is one of the essentials. Study the Bible. If you don't currently have a quiet time with God each day, as I said before, don't wait for things to get better. Before you decide to live better. Start now. Make this time. Be brutal with your calendars and set aside time for prayer and Bible study. And number three, ministry. This is where we kick into overdrive. This is where the application comes, where great things can take place. There are some things, the deepest lessons about Jesus Christ can only be learned when we do ministry for Him. They are not available. They may be theoretically, you know, on the surface known by those who only do the first two, prayer and Bible study, but only those who intentionally do regular ministry with and for Jesus Christ can learn the top lessons about Him. That's just the way that it works. You see, Jesus is out there seeking to save that which is lost. If we want to be with Jesus, we need to be where Jesus is. And if Jesus is seeking to reach them, we need to be doing the same. You saw it earlier. One of the signs of the end of time is that the gospel goes to all the world. It's not going to be done by angels going to and fro. It's not going to be done because Jesus sits on the moon with a megaphone and says, hey, everybody, wake up. It's going to be done because there are dedicated Christians that are reaching out, that are saying to their friends and their neighbors, there's a better way. I know a way out. COVID-19 doesn't have to scare the socks off of you. There's a better day coming. I know who can take you there. Prayer, Bible study, and ministry. You do these three things, and it will take you to the place where you can wait well for Jesus' return. Now, I confess it's tempting to stop there. Because really, I mean, this is kind of the whole package. Being a real Christian, walking with Jesus, studying his word, particularly the portions of prophecy, letting his spirit lead you, doing ministry, helping others to know Christ, in whatever way God has gifted you to do. This is the lion's share of how to wait well. But there is one more key that I'd like to give you, because I think we just might need it on occasion. It's found in Revelation chapter 21, verse 1. Revelation chapter 21, verse 1. This is towards the end of the book of Revelation. We have already passed Revelation 12 and 13, which is kind of, Revelation 12, 13, and 14, thematically speaking, that's the heart message of the book of Revelation. The book of Revelation is this chiastic structure where you kind of go up to the middle. That's where the main point is in Hebrew eschatology, that type of writing. It's in the middle, not at the end. And so we've already gotten the three angels' messages, the core message of the book of Revelation. But here at, geographically speaking, the end of the book here, there's only one more chapter after 21, we find this key to waiting well. John here is looking, he's in vision. He says, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, now the dwelling of God is with men, and he will live with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. He who was seated on the throne said, I am making everything new. This second key to waiting well for the return of Jesus Christ is keep your eye on the other side. Keep your eye on the other side. You say, the other side of what? On the other side of where we are currently at and where we are just about to go into. On this side of things, we've got all kinds of trouble and difficulty. On this side that we still have before us, the mark of the beast, the loss of religious liberty, mass global persecution. On this side of things, there's already disease, pestilence, plagues, things that are taking people's lives, that are transforming the way that they live in a negative, not a positive direction. On this side of things, we are a people that is now facing the prospect of being just on the cusp of Jesus coming back, and the world is growing more chaotic. It seems like sometimes by the day, we don't know what the future holds on this side of things. And let's just be honest, with or without COVID-19, the fact of the matter is, on this side of things, we have daily pain, disappointment, irritations, problems, challenges that we cannot seem to get through, families disintegrating, people that we love and have longed to spend all of our days with that pass away from disease or some other accident, things that go wrong on this side. Who can count them? But on the other side, Jesus says, behold, I will make all things new. All of the funerals will be in the past. All of the difficulties that we face now, pain, misfortune, wars, atrocities, etc., all of those will be receding into an ever-distancing rearview mirror. On the other side, we will be able to see friends and never have to say goodbye again. On the other side, we'll be able to be not just in heaven for 1,000 years, but then on this earth, not as it is now, with all of the difficulties and pain and disappointments and the world falling apart at the seams. No, it will be an earth that is made new and fresh and whole. On the other side, most of all, we will be with Jesus. And it doesn't get any better than that. You know, I'm not a prophet or a son of a prophet, but I feel fairly strongly that when the days that lie just before us do come, and there is great persecution, and Christians are forced to flee, and all of the institutions melt away, in our darkest hour, I suspect strongly that that which keeps us courageous will be that we keep our eye firmly on the other side of the pain that we will then currently be going through. Jesus is coming back, and this world will be transformed, and we will be with him forever on the other side. Church family, I don't know all that the future holds. But I do know that great events are here right now, with many more potentially on the horizon. Things are happening. We must be awake. If God's gift of prophecy is to be a source of peace and power to us, then we must learn to wait well for his return. We must be real Christians. We must be people that truly do follow Jesus, that we appreciate the perks and the institutions that faith has brought to us over the years, but we never mistake them for a real relationship with Jesus. And yes, we must keep our eyes on the other side of this mess that we're currently in, when all will be made new, all will be transformed, never to return to what it was again. We live in momentous times. May God grant us his peace, his power, and his light, that we may see the true meaning of Bible prophecy, that we might be found ready and waiting well when he returns. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we believe now, Lord, that your coming is indeed closer than when we first believed. The time will come when that roll will be called. You will announce, Lord, to this world your coming, and you will invite all those who have trusted in you to join you in your return to your home, Lord, in heaven. Lord, when that day comes, each one of us wants to be there. And Lord, we can think of dozens and dozens of people that we want to be there too. I pray that we would be people that wait well for you. That yes, Lord, look with maturity on the signs around us. That we get excited, Lord, we see that yes, your coming could be right at the door. And that have, Lord, the temperance to wait patiently, perseveringly, passionately, longing for your return. Teach us, Lord, to be a people that do pray, that do study, and that share. Now more than ever, Lord, your message needs to be heard. There's a world out there that is struggling for hope. You have it. We know you. Please help us to make you known. Bless us, Lord, that we indeed might have a mighty harvest prepared for you when you return. This we pray in your name, Jesus. Amen.